Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining Nossaman's webinar, Navigating COVID-19 for the Right-of-Way Industry. Before we get started, I wanted to take this opportunity to express our thoughts and best wishes for the health and safety of you and your family and friends and communities, and also express our gratitude for continuing to help move forward critical infrastructure projects during this challenging time. We apologize we weren't able to host our annual Eminent Domain seminars in person this year, but hopefully this event brings together our industry virtually and helps answer your questions as we continue to adapt in this rapidly changing environment. We had nearly 400 registrations, so thank you to all of our clients, consultants, and friends for participating. Before we jump into the details, I wanted to go through a few quick housekeeping matters. One is, because we're providing continuing education credit, we're required to insert periodic polling questions randomly just to make sure that you're paying attention. So I apologize in advance for that. Once the webinar is complete, you'll receive a CLE completion certificate via email. If you'd like a certificate of attendance for IRWA continuing education credit or any other CE program, please feel free to reach out to Jessica Koo. Additionally, this webinar will be recorded and will be sent to everyone who is registered, and the slide deck will also be included with that email later this evening. After the webinar is complete, you're going to see a survey for our program, and obviously we very much appreciate it if you took the time to fill that out and provide your candid feedback. Our goal is to try to get through this program in under an hour and leave some time for questions and answers at the end. And for those of you that submitted questions at the time of enrollment, we'll do our best to address those during the webinar. But if you have any questions throughout this presentation, please go ahead and type those into the questions panel, which expands after you click on that question mark icon on the webinar. We'll do our best to answer them at the end of the session, but if for some reason you can't stay, the Q&A session will also be included in the recording so you can hear those answers at a later time. And questions are being submitted anonymously, so feel free to ask anything you want, no matter how silly you think it is. And if for any reason we don't get to your questions, feel free to reach out to us via phone or email, or we'll do our best to reach out to you afterwards personally. With that, we will go ahead and get started. So for our presenters today, we have five of us participating. I am Brad Kuhn, the chair of Nossaman's Eminent Domain and Valuation Practice Group. And with me, I have four of my outstanding colleagues and partners, Bernadette Duran Brown, David Grayler, Rick Rail, and Artin Shaverdian. This is the first time we've tried doing a webinar with five speakers in five different locations. So please bear with us if we have any technical issues or you see kids running through the background, we're gonna do our best. As far as the agenda for today goes, we have kind of 10 hot button topics that we're going to cover. We have them listed here, but basically we're going to go through the status of construction of infrastructure projects, issues with court closures, filing and service delays, how to conduct board meetings, issues that we're seeing with title and recording issues, temporary construction easements and potentially expirations with those. Other litigation challenges that we're seeing, relocation problems, valuation problems, and other appraisal and site inspection issues. So with that, we will go ahead and get started. And our first topic is dealing with the impact of COVID-19 on construction. So in California, construction of infrastructure projects has been deemed an essential service, meaning that it is exempt from some of the shelter in place orders that have been issued. So organizations involved in these construction projects can continue operations. That includes industries such as communications, energy, transportation, water, government facilities, and real estate's also been deemed an essential service. So that should cover the work of many of the right-of-way agents, appraisers, and others involved in the delivery of infrastructure projects. However, this is going to vary by jurisdiction, and local jurisdictions may have much more heightened or restricted requirements. So please be sure to check with your local government agency before you move forward. In just the last day or so, I've seen Santa Clara and some of the Bay Area communities issue restrictions on what constitutes a construction project that is exempt and considered an essential service. And I've also heard places like Ventura County have placed restrictions and deemed that real estate activities are not considered essential. So again, it's important to look at that on a jurisdiction by jurisdiction basis and follow it, because it seems to be changing rapidly every single day. So if construction is deemed an essential service, are we still going to see potential delays? And I think the answer is possibly yes. As I mentioned, some jurisdictions are treating the shelter in place order as precluding construction. And in other locations, contractors are experiencing shortages in necessary labor or materials or equipment. And there could be delays associated with the construction techniques that are taking place to affect appropriate social distancing, or simply associated with getting the necessary permits or approvals for construction activities when other sectors are shut down. In fact, we've heard several agencies report that contractors have considered or have exercised force majeure provisions in their construction contracts, which suggests that some activities are slowing down or not going according to schedule. Every construction contract is probably going to have a different provision of what constitutes force majeure and how that can be interpreted. So please feel free to reach out if you have specific questions on your contract. But we have a lengthy article on Nossaman's website that we'll post here at the end of the webinar that kind of goes through force majeure contracts and how to interpret those. On the flip side, and perhaps one of the bright spots of the situation is we are seeing some agencies report accelerating construction activities. Because construction is viewed as a significant economic driver, it's something that a lot of government agencies are still trying to pursue and keep things moving to help with the economy. I've also seen government agencies streamlining or easing certain permits or approval requirements, including related to environmental obligations. And a lot of impediments that you would typically experience with a construction project, whether it be traffic or issues related to limited work hours or interference with business, a lot of those are lessened with the shelter in place requirements. So there may be some projects that can take advantage of that, or also take advantage of some federal stimulus dollars that look to expedite certain key projects. In fact, I believe just today, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi announced that their proposal for a fourth stimulus bill would direct hundreds of billions of dollars into infrastructure projects in certain key areas, including clean water upgrades and broadband access and other bridges and rail and other forms of public transit. I know we have a national audience here, just to kind of provide you with a little bit of overview of what's taking place across the country. I've seen some states such as Pennsylvania and Washington and Vermont have clear bright line rules that construction is not deemed an essential service and therefore it's completely shut down. Again, California has taken a different approach so far, deeming that construction is vital to continue to move forward and work for the economy. Again, there are some examples also of states and projects that are being accelerated. We've seen that in Hawaii and Indiana. I recently heard an example of OCTA completing a major utility relocation project ahead of schedule because businesses were closed and there was little traffic in the area. And this is an article just from this week discussing LA Metro looking to expedite the West Side Subway project to take advantage of the fact that there are significant business closures and lulls in tourists and traffic. So again, this is something that agencies should be looking into and considering if there's opportunities to expedite construction and complete projects on a more expedited basis.
Okay, I'm next going to talk about COVID-19's impact on our judicial system. Obviously, courts are a large gathering take place and are impacted because of it. We do have quite a few people here from other states. I know we have registrants from states like Hawaii, Texas, Nevada, and even Michigan and Oregon. It's important that you check whatever jurisdiction your matter is pending in, because rules are going to differ depending on what courthouse you are in. Even in California, rules are going to vary across counties. And even at the federal district court level, they're going to vary from district court to district court. Most of what I'm going to talk about is going to focus on California. In California, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court issued an order shortly after the outbreak that all jury trials have been suspended for at least 60 days. That impacts any case set for trial from March 23rd through May 23rd. In essence, all of those trial dates were vacated. They were not continued 60 days, they're just vacated, which means that the individual judge where the case is pending is going to either have to issue a minute order resetting the new trial date or set a trial setting conference to bring the parties in to set a new trial date. That's going to likely have some major calendaring impacts, because even on a best case scenario, often you can't get a trial date for a year when you show up for a trial setting conference. And cases that were set for trial outside of that May 23rd window were not continued. So courts are still going to have a lot of trials scheduled through the rest of the year, and how they're going to squeeze in during that compacted schedule other trials is going to be a challenge. In LA Superior Court, that window is extended even further to June 22nd. So cases set for trial up to June 22nd have been continued and are going to need to be reset. Because courts are essentially closed right now, they're also not having any hearings except for on an emergency basis. And in many courthouses, that's going on at least through mid-April. And I've seen that even those deadlines are going to be pushed into mid-May. You may be able to get an emergency hearing if it qualifies as an emergency matter, but that too will be difficult because a lot of in-person hearings are not being allowed. Even after the courts reopen, it's uncertain what the situation is going to look like. We expect that there's going to be a lot of backlog. Traditional hearings sessions are going to take a lot longer to process. I have some friends who are judges who have told me that they're also working remotely right now. And so while they're able to do some work right now, you can expect that they're not being as productive. And so that's going to only add to the backlog. And finally, at least in California, we don't think appellate courts are going to be as impacted because they don't need as many people to get together, and they've decided to just keep pushing forward with oral arguments through the use of telephones and other technologies. There are some open questions and unknowns right now in our right-of-way industry. For example, what do you do with a motion for possession or any other necessary motion that was set for hearing and then taken off calendar because of the court closures? It's possible that we could create an argument that the motion for possession constitutes an emergency if it's a critical path element that could result in substantial delay damages to a public agencies. But that is an open question. It's not been tested yet, and I suspect it will be up to the discretion of each individual judge. Even after the courts reopen, it's going to be very difficult, we anticipate, to get prompt hearing dates. One tool we can use is to file ex parte applications to try to get earlier hearing dates. But again, that might have some mixed results depending on how impacted courts are. It's also challenging right now to get certified copies of pleadings, which obviously has a lot of impact for folks dealing in the right-of-way industry. Eminent domain matters are also generally entitled to priority, but we don't know whether or not we'd be able to use that particular tool to try to accelerate trial processes. There are also always judicial vacancies, and so the governor is constantly vetting new candidates to fill those vacancies. I know from serving on LACBA Judicial Appointments Committee that we're slowing down in our process, and I know the Jenny Commission is as well, so if there's any delay in being able to fill judicial vacancies going forward, that could also add to the backlog. And then finally, even after the shelter in place restrictions are lifted, it's unclear what jury service is going to look like. In the past, as we've all seen, there's a lot of people assembled in a room together, and whether or not that's still going to happen or whether or not people are going to be willing to do that, there may be some changes that we can expect in terms of how the processes look for jury service. And I think that brings us to our very first polling question. So I guess we can go ahead and launch the question. And the question is, how long do you think the shelter in place order will last in California? You can go ahead and vote end of April, end of May, end of June through fall of 2020, or the catch-all, I have no idea. So Jessica, I guess whenever you're ready, you can close the poll. And there are the results. A lot of optimists. Okay.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I hope you and your families are all healthy and safe, and thanks for joining us today. As David just mentioned, so we have a lot of court closures that are impacting what we do on a daily basis. In particular, one of the issues, of course, that comes up is, well, how does this impact our filings? Does it mean that if we have courts that are closed or partially closed, that we don't have to file documents? Well, it certainly creates some challenges. We do know that certain courts have now closed even their e-filing and fax filing systems and services, and we're not able to file, of course, the traditional method for some of those courts that have closed down the courthouses entirely, and some courts that use Dropbox systems, and you would typically Dropbox your filings and they would be filed on that day. Those are still available, as are the e-filing and the fax filings. But again, it all depends on sort of the jurisdiction that you're in and what you're filing and how the court's processing those things. Partial court closures, however, does not mean that no filings need to be done. So that's an important thing to be aware of. Although in certain courthouses for certain time periods, limited time periods, the courts have issued orders indicating that your filing deadlines have been moved for purposes of your filings if they fall within that limited period. And that limited period essentially is considered a holiday. So if you had something due during that limited period, it would now sort of get pushed out by the number of days that the court is fully closed. But that does not apply to every jurisdiction and every courthouse. Certainly in California, we have some that are accepting filings and expect that you will file your documents in a timely manner. And we have those that are completely closed and are not. So that's a very specific jurisdictional question that needs to be looked into. And then I would suggest that you and your counsel look into and plan ahead if you're planning on filing documents or if documents need to be filed. So question is then what is the filing status of the various jurisdiction? And I gave you, since I practice in Southern California, I gave you just a sort of a limited examples of what can happen and where we are with things as of yesterday. This is sort of the most up-to-date. This is the most up-to-date as far as what's going on in some of the more local courts in California is concerned. Currently, new matter filings in Los Angeles and Orange County are being processed within 24 hours. So if you have a new case that you're filing, we get a case number immediately and it is sent back to us, and we're able to proceed. Orange County is a little bit slower, but they are processing them. So when you do e-file documents in Orange County, they do get the date stamp that you actually filed. You just don't get your documents back for a couple days. So it's about taking them about 48 to 72 hours to get back to you. San Bernardino has a Dropbox. However, documents are being dropped in the Dropbox and there's currently no processing. My understanding is that with respect to Sacramento, that it's very much the same. There's a very limited Dropbox for Sacramento for only certain actions. So Sacramento, Contra Costa, Alameda, those are all closed, and we'd have to look into those particular jurisdictions. San Diego is an e-filing court, so you can e-file in San Diego, but again, not processing. So again, I would recommend that you speak to your counsel and make sure you're planning ahead based on what you need to accomplish. Obtaining motion hearing dates is another question we've been asked recently. Again, fortunately for some of the courthouses, we've been able to obtain hearing dates immediately. Courts are assuming that they'll be back within the next 35 to 60 days. Now, that's typically what you would need anyway before you would have a hearing date on any particular type of motion. In particular, our motions for possessions get set out 90 days. So when we try to get those hearing dates, in most courtrooms, we're able to set those out for right now. However, I suspect with all of the continuance of the various hearings, those dates are going to start getting taken up. And so when you try to log in to try to get hearing dates online or through the clerk's office, those are going to start getting pushed out. So if you have cases that need to be filed, it would probably be very wise at this point to make sure that you're getting those done as quickly as possible. And David spoke about delays in issuing some of the non-emergency orders. It's unclear what the courts will now do if you have a motion set for possession, but we suspect that's something, of course, that we'll learn about as we go along. Fortunately, we haven't had any of those issues. Unfortunately, this just provides you with a lot of questions that you need to be asking yourself and planning, because we don't have the answers to all of this just yet, because this is all uncharted territory and we're trying to navigate. But hopefully this gives you some things to think about if you do have cases that are either filed or planning on filing. There's many resources online, but some of the ones that we've been relying on are the ones that are listed at the bottom of this slide. And you can click on any of those and they provide very concise summaries of what each courthouse is doing, what their availabilities are. You can organize them by courts that are closed or open. So I for instance, organized this particular one yesterday based on which courts were actually closed and whether they have Dropbox or e-filing availability, what the expected opening date is based on the orders that are issued. And this one is from the First Legal, which is the second web link that's provided there. With respect to service, of course, that's a whole nother issue, because with the stay-at-home orders currently, there's certainly going to be some difficulties and challenging times in trying to serve whoever it is that you need to serve. In particular, if this is your first service of an individual or an entity serving a summons and complaint, locating those agents for service of process has been somewhat challenging, because most people are working from home, so going to their places of business, we're not able to find them, and we've had some of those come up in the last week or so. Even with respect to serving entities that utilize a service for agent of process like CT Corp, it's important to understand that they also have limited operating hours, so they are accepting service, but on a limited basis. So again, if you're planning on sending a process server out there, you might want to make sure that they understand that issue. It's entirely possible that alternate services can be a solution to this. And when we say alternate service, well, what I mean by that is, substitute service, serving someone else, posting the property, et cetera. But it's unclear whether the courts would waive the a requirement that we personally serve, and that's something we haven't seen just yet, but it is a possibility. If we're unable to serve someone personally, we may want to pursue the route of alternate service. Subsequent services after you've made the initial service seem to be has started out as a concern, but seems like that most attorneys, based on the orders that were issued by the Judicial Council, that attorneys are to cooperate with each other and provide, extend professional courtesies and stipulate to continuances. One of the things that's happened is everyone is stipulating to e-service of documents. That is a requirement in California that you actually agree to e-service, so they can't just serve you via email. It needs to be agreed to in advance. So if you intend on serving documents and you intend to rely on e-service, make sure you reach out to opposing counsel and come to an agreement as to that. So that brings us to our next poll question, which is, What is your role at your current organization? Project management slash construction in the legal arena, appraisal, right-of-way acquisition, or relocation consultant, or the catch-all other? Excellent. Looks like we've got a lot of right-of-way acquisition consultants and about equal parts of appraisal, legal, and project management and others. So,
okay, next we're going to turn to handling board meetings. And given the shelter in place and social distancing guidelines, many public agencies are completely canceling board meetings or are handling them telephonically. To address the situation, Governor Newsom's issued an executive order, which is referred to as N-29-20, which relaxes Brown Act requirements and allows meetings via teleconference. But the full impact of that is not yet clear, and I think it's going to take some real planning on behalf of public agencies or other organizations that are holding board meetings. Here's a quote or pull out from that executive order, and as you can see, it specifically allows for public agencies to hold meetings via teleconference and make those meetings accessible telephonically or otherwise electronically to the public. While we adjust to that, public agencies really need to start planning in advance, particularly with issues of, for example, how are they going to adopt resolutions of necessity? Or how do you give proper notice? How do you make sure a property owner has an opportunity to appear and be heard? Aside from the political sensitivity of moving forward with the resolution of necessity right now, and the difficulties and sensitivity of doing that via teleconference, agencies are going to need to make sure that they are appropriately set up to address these types of issues and give property owners an opportunity to make comments or present their record before resolutions are adopted. Agencies are also going to have to consider how do you handle closed session board meetings and make sure you protect the confidentiality to address things like real property negotiations or approvals of settlements or purchase agreements, or how to obtain approvals to issue a final offer of compensation for a pending imminent action. So those are a lot of things that need to be thought about and considered in advance, and working with your IT departments and anyone else involved to make sure that you can move those forward and still comply with the legal requirements.
And I'm gonna cover pretty quickly title and recording issues. We've been asked a lot, how do we continue to record things? That's obviously a big concern for everyone who's in real estate profession. A lot, if not all, of the recorders' offices throughout California are closed, but they have posted on their websites how to obtain or submit documents. So a lot of them is US good old snail mail is one of the best ways to send documents to them. Some have online portals to receive, you know, vital records and things. You can go through online services. Some still have phone people at the office answering phones, but from what I've heard, those are really jammed up. So yeah, you can record documents. It just varies by method. So like I said, certain counties, you can mail it in and that's the only way to get it to the recorder's office right now. There's no over-the-counter service. Electronic recording is still available, however, and that is really key for title and escrow. Title and escrow companies are authorized secure electronic recording submitters, so for them, it is business as usual. They are allowed to submit electronic documents electronically for recording if that county is set up for electronic recording and using services to do that. If you're not using an escrow company, one company you can use is recordmydocs.com. They're nationwide. They handle all manner of documents and have a lot of information on their website. We had a question about implications of recording late. Our best suggestion would be to try to reach out to opposing parties, parties in the transaction early on, if that's something you anticipate. You know, if your only option is to submit it by snail mail, maybe we need to have a coordination with the opposing party to make sure everybody's on the same page in terms of potential delay. And acquiring title, from what I'm hearing from my contacts at title escrow companies, you can still get title reports, you can still get litigation guarantees, business as usual. There's a 1 to 2 day delay on getting new documents and updates. Like date downs usually take about 48 hours. We've had questions about notaries. There are still mobile notaries out there that are going to people's houses and businesses. And I've confirmed with a lot of the UPS locations are open because UPS is an essential service. And you can check their websites to see if they have notaries available. Like other things that need to be submitted to counties that are usually over-the-counter processes, such as maps. Some counties accept them electronically. It really varies. That's one topic that is not as widespread as electronic recording or recording by mail. Certain counties, you can submit all of your map documents through mail. So make sure to check their websites. Some of them have very detailed lists of which pages you have to send and number of copies and things like that. So that stuff can still be processed for some jurisdictions. It just depends on whether you're able to provide that in your project.
Thanks, Bernadette. I'm gonna talk a little bit about something that we've gotten a lot of questions on, which is what happens to my temporary construction easements that are expiring due to construction slowdowns or other interference due to COVID? How do I deal with that situation? If your TCE was condemned in a court proceeding or is in the process of being condemned, there is likely no provision within that TCE to extend it. We did get some questions about whether the concept of force majeure that contractors are talking about, sort of the act of God that says, you know, I'm excused from performing because it's out of my control. If public agencies could take advantage of that and use a force majeure argument to extend their TCE, we've chatted about it among our group. Consensus is we just don't see any way to do that. I think it might be different if there was a TCE that required a payment and there was a reason that the agency couldn't timely make the payment because the board wasn't meeting or because there was no one around to cut checks due to COVID. That might be a force majeure argument. But if you're looking to extend a TCE, which is what we get most questions about, that's not going to protect you. I did want to say specifically about negotiated TCEs. You need to go back and look at those. If they weren't condemned but were a voluntary negotiation, you may be surprised to see a lot of your TCEs actually do have extension provisions in them. We've always tried to negotiate those when we can. I'm sure a lot of agencies try to get them. Obviously, some owners won't give you, but take a look, see if you have extension provision. I'm going to caution you that extension provisions are probably going to be treated a lot like real estate options or lease extension options, and the courts are very strict about those. You need to very strictly comply with the requirements. So make sure you're paying close attention. Is there a specific term of the extension? Is there a date by which you give notice? What manner that you have to give notice? Do you have to tender the payment for the extension at the time you exercise the extension? Pay very close attention to all of those things, because if you have an extension right and you don't exercise it properly, you could well lose that extension right. So the next question is, if there's no right to extend in your negotiated TCE, or if you've condemned your TCE, or if you're in condemnation, what do you do if you need to extend? The obvious answer here is, you know, try to talk to the property owner, see if you can negotiate something. Property owners may be more flexible at this point, even if they wouldn't give you extension rights when you originally got your TC, they might be willing to do so now. So that's obviously the best plan. If that does not work, you're going to want to start planning for going into a new court proceeding to try to get another temporary construction easement to capture that period of time that you're going to need at the end of construction. Obviously, if you've got a TC that still has a year or more left on it right now and you need more time, it may be easy or easier to get possession of a new TC if your window is shorter, and particularly in light of the filing and service complications that others have already talked about, you may not be able to get those additional possession rights in time to keep your project moving. And that sort of raises the last question, which is, well, if I need more time and I can't negotiate it and I can't get it in time through the courts, what do I do? Do I just keep working? And that's a really tough question. Again, something we kicked around among our group. I think the consensus here is, if you've got a TC that is expiring in the very short term and you need a small amount of additional time, for example, your TC is expiring at the end of April and you think you're going to need an extra 2 weeks, I think the advice is, if you can't negotiate an extension, just keep doing your work. Don't stop your construction. Get your project done. Now, I should caution, if you do that, yes, it probably is a taking. Yes, you may be liable in inverse condemnation. In a lot of states, including California, if there's a taking, you're also going to be liable for attorney's fees. But in the grand scheme of things, particularly when a lot of things are shut down, there's little traffic and a lot of businesses are closed, you can get away with extending your TCs on your own, probably without causing a lot of damage. Again, we view this as sort of an option of last resort, but I would not stop construction on a crucial infrastructure project if you need a small amount of time extension on your TC. I think the cost and risks associated with stopping and going through the court process probably at this point outweigh the risk of liability to an inverse condemnation claim. But again, please take that as a last resort, not a regular practice. And that leads us into our next polling question. What is your biggest right-of-way concern related to the COVID-19 crisis? And the question, the options are construction delays, litigation impacts, issues getting possession, temporary construction easement expirations, which I just talked about, or something else. And it looks like we're pretty well split. We've got construction delays, litigation and impacts, and possession concerns all with about the same score. So lots of different concerns out there. Thanks for your input.
Okay, so next we're gonna talk about some other litigation challenges that we're seeing and that may occur. One obvious thing is depositions. With stay-at-home orders in place, it's difficult for lawyers and witnesses to meet in order to do a deposition. Over the last several weeks, I have tried some web-based technologies to complete a couple of depositions, but I have to say they're not ideal. They're not nearly as good. If you're defending the deposition, you lose the ability to talk to your witness immediately or during a break about what is happening. If you're taking the deposition, there's some downsides to it. You lose the ability really to be able to read the witness in the same way, engage how they're reacting to questions posed. If you want to video record the deposition, it's difficult using that technology. And a couple of times I did it, I noticed that there was a time lag between the audio and the video that you're seeing, which also adds some distraction to it. That said, some depositions do lend themselves well to telephonic depositions or web-based, but it's really not nearly as good. Now, Governor Newsom did issue an executive order that will allow the Judicial Council to modify rules on depositions. Currently, or until now, depositions were required to be taken in person.
The new rules are going to allow for them to be taken remotely. And, you know, depending on how long this lasts, we may be left with no choice but to choose a less good option and to do these depositions through the use of technology. Written discovery can also be a challenge in order to retrieve documents or pull information necessary. You know, access working can make challenges with that. And I think the key here is just to try to prepare for that, work often and early with your counsel, and try to reach agreements with the other side if extensions are needed. Subpoenas to third parties are also a possibility if they possess information you need to litigate your case. With businesses being closed, it could be difficult to serve them. And so just build in a little extra time for that. There's a lot of situations in eminent domain that require the simultaneous exchange of information, appraisals, final offers and demands, things like that. That can be done with technology as opposed to an in-person meeting or using FedEx. But if you're going to do it with an email, then, you know, get on the phone with your opposing counsel and say, I'm hitting send now, and coordinate it that way. It should work pretty well. Mediations, arbitrations, those kinds of things also are best done in person, particularly mediations, I think. You know, a mediator to really be effective needs to also be able to read the room and see how people are reacting to facts and offers and demands. I've seen some ADR providers trying to do these things through technology. I just don't know how well they'll work. I've not yet tried it. Arbitrations are generally being postponed as well, because while they can be done with technology, again, it's not the same as being able to try to persuade an arbitrator in person. And because of shelter in place restrictions, a lot of the ADR providers are closed right now, except for through remote work. A lot of mediations and arbitrations are being continued. I would suspect that some of the more in-demand neutrals are going to have impacted schedules, you know, 60, 90, 120 days from now. And then in terms of other technical things, you know, cutting a check can be challenging if all your staff is working remotely. So you'll want to plan for things like that. And finally, if you happen to need to travel to other states, take a deposition or meet with a witness or a party or something like that, you want to check travel restrictions. We learned recently on a matter that Texas has an order in place, for example, that requires a 14-day shelter in place for anyone traveling to Texas from California right now. And I know there are other similar restrictions like that. And obviously that can have an impact on our ability to do what we need to do.
All right, thanks, David. Let's talk about relocation issues, which is something that we're also sort of seeing and some challenges related to that. We currently haven't seen any restrictions to carry out any relocation or acquisition activities issued by either FHWA or any other oversight agencies, including state or federal agencies. So while we haven't seen any of that, it doesn't obviously mean that we're free to move forward and do all of that. There certainly are going to be some challenges, because typically displacements and relocating people is as a result of these projects has always been considered as one of the most sort of sensitive things that we do in the right-of-way industry, and in particular now with the exacerbated sort of situation under COVID-19, the challenges are going to be a little bit larger than they used to be. With some of these stay-at-home orders, the question, of course, really is how do the right-of-way agents and the displacees tour properties or even engage in any type of relocation, reestablishment type activities? That's been one of the challenges. And of course, within California, under the governor's March 22 order, which clarified what essential critical infrastructure workers are, there was nothing there included that would indicate that right-of-way and or relocation agents can proceed with these types of activities. However, again, there's nothing sort of precluding it from any of the oversight agencies, and arguably perhaps in having the authority to move forward with these public projects, as I think Brad mentioned earlier, under the various orders, you know, perhaps it could be lumped into that, well, we can't really move forward with a public project if we don't actually secure these properties by displacing and continuing with relocation activities. So it might be a far stretch, but those are some of the considerations there. Of course, logistics of doing any of these types of activities is certainly going to be difficult. You know, for those who have already filed actions, and if you have a order for prejudgment possession pending, and that's what you're going to be relying on in displacing people and relocating them, there's certainly some of the legal challenges of possibly having to enforce those orders for possession. It's unclear currently whether courts are going to allow for writs to be issued and whether those writs can be executed if you have an order for possession. One of the questions we have received is, you know, with the laws currently restricting evictions, whether agencies can still proceed with displacements. Just as a reminder, I think displacements for projects doesn't necessarily equate to UD evictions for failure to pay rent. As most of you know, in California at least, there's the governor's order, which provides a moratorium or 60-day moratorium on evicting tenants who fail to pay rent. Some of the jurisdictions have more restrictive orders now in place. For instance, I read this morning that Riverside has now extended that to a six-month moratorium on evicting people who fail to pay rent, and it actually also includes commercial businesses within that order. So, but with all that said, it's unclear, and I'm not sure that means that displacements for a public project are necessarily impacted, and that those would apply to displacements in a public project, because typically when we're displacing, we usually have a relocation site, and it's not for purposes of failure to pay rent. But of course, there is the practical implications of whether this is the right time to be moving people and what kind of PR that may be generating for public agencies if during this crisis we're forcing people out of their homes or out of their businesses. So I think those practical implications and the perceptions that may leave may trump whether we can actually do the displacements or not. Let's see. And let's go into valuation problems.
Okay, we're going to talk a little bit about some of the valuation problems you're going to see. We're going to try to get through this quickly, these last couple of slides, because I know we've got some questions and want to be mindful of your time. But one of the valuation issues that's always existed in eminent domain, but is really going to be at the forefront now, is how do you differentiate between damage caused by the construction of your project or the operation of your project versus damage caused by outside forces? This is particularly problematic in Part 8 cases where you're facing severance damage claims, and either the property owner or the business owner may be making claims that their property value is going down, or that their business is going down as a result of your project. The appraisers are going to have to really work hard here to try to siphon out the damage that is actually caused by the project or damage caused by things, for example, the stay-at-home orders, the shelter in place, businesses being shut down, rents not getting paid. These are all going to have major impacts on property and property values and business values, none of which obviously has anything to do with the project. But the appraisers are going to have to find a way to differentiate that, and the landowner and business owner attorneys and appraisers are obviously going to try to capture as much of the damage as they can and attribute it to the project, because they can get reimbursed for that. So that's going to, I think, become a major problem as we move forward, particularly for partakes and construction that is ongoing right now while these stay-at-home and shelter-in-place orders are in effect. The next thing I wanted to talk about is sort of anticipating what may come next a little bit. I think it's reasonable to assume that we may see some declining property values in at least some areas, particularly if these restrictions stay in place for very long. We've just talked about, you know, there can't be evictions for failure to rent. Well, that's all well and good for the tenant, but the property owner may owe mortgage payments, and even if they get temporary relief, it doesn't change the fact they are eventually going to owe that money. And if the tenants can't pay and eventually go out of business, or some of them, how do they get that money? How do they find new tenants? There's a lot of reasons to expect that the real estate market may decline. One of the things we saw in the last real estate recession was a situation where agencies were condemning property that was actually underwater, meaning that the property owner owed more on their mortgage than the property was worth. And that causes a lot of problems when you try to condemn. In California, one thing to pay attention to is it a purchase money loan or is it a refinance? There are differences in how those work in terms of whether the lender can pursue the borrower beyond just the value of the property. But in cases where it's a refinance in particular, and the property is worth less than the amount, than the fair market value, agencies are going to have to struggle with how do we relocate people in those situations. Can people get new loans if they're in default or deficient on their existing loans? Are there ways for agencies to make additional payments? There are some creative solutions that were looked at about 8 or 10 years ago when we were in this position, looking at things like last resort housing rules, purchase price differential payments, and other creative solutions to try to deal with the problem. But I think you should anticipate that we may see some of that coming back. One other note, last time there was a big movement by a company, maybe a couple of companies, but one in particular, trying to actually advocate for condemning the mortgages themselves rather than the real property to sort of solve the underwater problem. It got a lot of press and a lot of publicity. I don't think it actually ever went anywhere, but we may see some of those efforts again if the real estate market really does get upside down. And then the last thing is, what does this mean for data value? In California in particular, we have a data value scheme for our eminent domain cases that sort of assumes there's a rising market, and it freezes the data value at different points in time. Typically what we use is the date of deposit. But here, if we are going to see declining markets, there's an interesting question for agencies to think about. If they don't need possession right away, which is you need to make a deposit in order to get possession, but if you don't need possession, should you hold off on making that deposit and try to get a later value if the market is declining? There is some reason to believe that might be a successful strategy. The other way to get an early data value is for cases that go to trial within a year, then the filing date is your date. That's not likely to happen. So agencies may be able to manipulate the data value a little bit to their favor. One query is that ethical? If is it fair for agencies to play the market to intentionally stall the data value in the hope that the real estate market goes down? We're not going to delve too deeply in that, but it is something to watch out for again if we start to see a declining real estate market. With that, and I will turn it back to Bernadette.
Thanks, Rick. I'm going to go over these appraisal site inspection issues really quickly so that we have some time for questions. Obviously, stay-at-home orders present challenges for appraisers and relocation agents who need to physically visit a property, site inspections for pending litigation, to do pre-litigation deposits, personally visit comparables. What options you've got available is what we've done on our cases is reach out to opposing counsel and try and, as best you can, get an agreement and set a future date for an inspection. That way, set it now. And then if a stay-at-home order is extended, you can revisit that, but at least get something on calendar. I read just this morning about desktop appraisals, so appraisers trying to perform all of those usual in-person tasks by computer. So, using Google Street View and the historic views, things like that, to try and get a sense of the property without going out there. Another one is, an inspection drive-by. You go drive over to the property, stay in your car, take your photos. It works well for visiting comps or vacant properties where you're not going to run into a whole lot of people. And the other issue is with the court closures and delays that David was talking about, there's likely going to be dates that get pushed out. And so it may be best just to wait and try not to rush the appraisal process or inspection process. The inspections I anticipate would be most impacted were business appraisers and probably FF&E appraisers who would have to go into businesses and inspect, you know, how their operations are going or what equipment they've got. And even if you can get into a business, it may not be operating in the way that it normally would be. And so you may see a changed operation, reduced operations. And I anticipate there would be concerns about valuing the business based on what you see during this stay-at-home time. The Appraisal Institute and others have asked that appraisal services be deemed essential. Appraisers that work for banking institutions are free to continue their appraisal work because they're part of the financial institutions, which are essential. Anything having to do with purchasing homes, those types of transactions, appraisers that do that work are considered essential. Outside of that, it's unclear where whether they are going to be considered essential. In some places like Tennessee, they have a whole list of things that are essential and appraisal services is one of them. And so it just depends by jurisdiction as to whether that's lumped into real estate services or infrastructure services, or if they call it out specifically like they did in Tennessee. And this is our last polling question, which is, how has COVID-19 impacted the progress of your projects? So projects are on an accelerated schedule, moving forward as usual, full steam ahead, experiencing delays, we're being selective with projects, or we foresee delays, stoppage to our projects. Give you a couple more seconds before we close the poll. Okay. So it looks like the majority of our audience is full steam ahead, and a good split between experiencing delays and foreseeing delays or stoppages. So that is interesting. Right now, we're going to take questions. If you have your hand raised in the little platform here, type it in the question box and I can get to that. And I'm going to start going through these questions that we already received. So a quick one that is related to grant deeds, since I'm speaking, I'll just keep going. What about wet signatures on grant deeds? Can you e-sign? The limitation there is that usually on deeds, you have to have it notarized. And so you'll have to be present with the notary to get those documents officially signed. I don't know of any electronic notary at this point. If they're out there, let me know. But that's the one shortfall in the electronic signatures on deeds or property transfers. Somebody asked about the status of Riverside County filings. Brad, we have a lot of cases in Riverside County courts. What are you seeing in terms of filing right now?
From what I've seen, we've been able to get documents filed. It's taking longer than usual to get case numbers and judges assigned to particular cases. All our hearings that have been scheduled over the next month or two have typically been pushed on the court's own motion. There are some that appear to still be going forward, perhaps only telephonically, but it depends on the department and it depends on the type of case and which judicial branch you're located in.
By the way, just to add to that, Bernadette, on Riverside County, they issued an order today, actually. The Riverside County issued a local order. Essentially, April 6th through April 24th is now considered a court holiday. So for purposes of filing documents under Code of Civil Procedure 12 and 12A, April 6th through April 24th are being treated as court holidays. So any filings that fall during that time period would be extended. And what I'm seeing on the courts, in the court's order, is that the court now is actually going to be completely closed until April 24th. A lot of cases, depending on the types of cases, and again, I just looked at this in the last couple of minutes as I saw the question and looked it up, but it looks like the court is providing for opportunities to move cases to other jurisdictions outside of Riverside County where the case needs to be heard immediately or if it's an emergency because of the closure.
Thanks, Artin. Another question we had was, what is force majeure for those in our audience that aren't familiar with that? Brad or Rick, do you guys want to deal with that?
Yeah, I mean, basically it's something, an event that takes place that is completely outside the control of the parties. Some typical examples would be an act of God, a riot, a strike, things of that nature. Again, a force majeure event is going to be defined differently in every construction contract, and whether it applies is going to really depend on the language. A lot of them have a broad-based language that says, or any other reasonable event that is not foreseen by the parties. So again, it's essentially something that was unanticipated or unplanned that prevents the parties from moving forward.
Thank you. One comment we had here on the desktop appraisals is, you know, it can be beneficial in some cases, but our writer has found that Google Earth, Street View, Land Vision, and other mapping software lag in terms of time in which vacant property on the software is actually constructed improvement if the appraiser had performed a site inspection. I've had that happen where trying to get, you know, just a screenshot for a maybe a trial exhibit, and what is shown in Google Earth or Street View is actually not how the property looks. So that's a really good comment, really good point. There's another question. How far do you think agencies can go in relocation given the eviction and Ellis Act moratoriums in Los Angeles? And can they go as far as notices of eligibility, notice to vacate, no notices at all? David or Artin, do you want to comment?
Artin, you covered some of that in terms of what can continue to be done on a relocation basis. I can talk briefly about Ellis Act if you want to answer the first piece.
Yeah, again, I haven't seen anything issued by any of the agencies, oversight agencies, on what types of notice can or cannot be provided at this point. But again, I think this goes beyond, at this point, what we can or can't do. I mean, if you do have an emergency situation where you need a particular parcel, I think it's something that you can probably do at this point. However, it's sort of the practical implications and the perception of displacing people in the current state of affairs that might be the more important thing to think about. But again, have not seen anything from any of the agencies, and I checked as early as this morning, FHWA, FRA, many of the other oversight agencies, and some of the ones in California, Caltrans. There have been no public announcements on whether notices or anything like that can't be done on public projects at this point.
In terms of Ellis Act, I mean, I think it's as distinguished from relocations that would be necessitated by eminent domain. We have come across the Ellis Act issue where a public agency has acquired property subject to rent control and has agreed to allow the tenants to remain in place after voluntarily acquiring that property. And all of a sudden, that tenant is entitled to protections under the Ellis Act or a rent stabilization ordinance. And that could require compliance with those rules, even though the property was necessarily acquired for a public project. So you'll want to be very careful if you're planning on doing that, in ensuring that you're not creating a brand new leasehold with the public agency being the landlord.
Thank you, guys. Since we talked about notaries, we've had a lot of very helpful comments from our audience talking about electronic notaries. California isn't one of the states that allows electronic notarization, but other states do. And so what we can do after the webinar is provide some resources on electronic notarization, which states allow that. And I appreciate the audience for chiming in on that issue. Another question we had is, for contracts that don't require a notary, is DocuSign an accepted and enforceable way to sign documents? I would say yes. Do the other panelists have any other comments on that one?
I see DocuSign becoming more and more common. I've actually done a lot of DocuSign recently, so I don't know if it's tested in court, but I think it's becoming pretty routine if you don't need a notary, and I wouldn't have any real concerns about using DocuSign to sign things.
Right. Question we've got here is, what's the source of facts and ex parte coverage handouts? Is it something our firm prepared, or an official court notice or order?
Yeah, I can answer that one. So the frequently asked question handout and the ex parte coverage handout all came directly from the LA Superior Court. It was sent to a bench bar committee from the presiding judge, Kevin Brazil himself.
Thanks, David. Are there other questions our audience has?
It looks like there were a few other helpful comments that I thought we'd maybe just pass on. One was that the Department of Homeland Security has identified residential and commercial real estate services as other community and government-based operations falling under essential critical infrastructure workers. And like I said, in California, they've also define real estate services as essential. So I think there's a broader based exception for those involved in the real estate industry, both appraisal and right-of-way services, that would probably qualify, absent something more jurisdiction specific. And then I know there was some questions about how do you deal with COVID-19 in the actual appraisal statement you're preparing, and Rick, I don't know if you have any thoughts of that. Of, you know, if you're preparing your appraisal statement, that's obviously something that's impacting the value, and how do you address that in the report?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's going to be an evolving situation. I think one of the interesting issues will be, do the appraisers need some kind of a written legal instruction from the lawyers about assumptions to make about COVID and how that works? I don't know that we're there yet. To me, this is sort of an issue that appraisers always have to deal with, which is, how do you separate project impacts from other economic factors? I think it's just going to become much more prominent. I'm not sure that there's anything special appraisers need to do. They're just going to need to do due diligence and try to really do the best they can to decide whether the impacts they're seeing are in fact caused by the project. If they're not caused by the project, then certainly in California, and I'm guessing in most jurisdictions, if not all, they wouldn't be compensable damages, and they shouldn't be considered for purposes of calculating severance damages.
Another question I will throw out to the panel is, has anyone heard of public agencies losing funding because of delay in eminent domain actions or obtaining certification of right-of-way? I haven't.
I've not heard of anything. I can try to dig out the link. I know that there was a question comment period or page, I think either FHWA or FTA, I think it was an FTA resource, where agencies could ask questions like that about that were specific to their project if they couldn't meet some of their contractual funding obligations, and they were getting answers about how they dealt with the situation. So I think that the federal government is likely to be pretty flexible on those things, and I will try to dig out that site, and we can send that around as well for that resource page.
Brad, there is a question about the Bay Area's new shelter order that was issued yesterday regarding construction. Did you see that? Do you want to address that question?
Yeah, the question, and I briefly mentioned this, the Bay Area's new shelter order issued yesterday specifically states that construction is restricted to projects immediately necessary to the maintenance, operation, or repair of essential infrastructure. And so if it's projects that aren't going to be starting or ready in a year, several years, how do you deal with that? And does it apply? I think there was one other example that was provided, that if the local public agency actually issues a letter saying that the project is critical or an essential service, I think that's an example of where the shelter in place order arguably wouldn't apply. And I know a lot of local transportation agencies and other agencies have been issuing letters to their right-of-way consultants and appraisers saying that the project that they're working on is an essential service and that they're allowed to continue to proceed with the project. And so that's something, if you're concerned about it as a right-of-way consultant or appraiser, talk with your agency that you're working with and see if that's something that they're willing to issue.
One other thing about that, pay attention to, if you are working on a project that is encompassed by that new order in the Bay Area, and therefore the construction does have to stop, it isn't necessarily a bright line that it has to stop immediately today. There are also provisions talking about bringing construction far enough along not to leave the construction site in an unsafe condition. And so it's not just a bright line that no one's allowed to be constructing today. So it's going to take some time to work through those, because obviously this has just happened within the last 24 hours. But there are some workarounds, at least temporarily, to keep things going and not sort of put the public at peril by leaving a giant hole in the ground, for example.
Since we are past our end time, I'm going to include one last participant question. But as Brad said, if you guys have additional questions, please feel free to reach out to us. We're happy to talk with any of you about the issues you may be experiencing. Last question is, can an agency pass on construction delay costs to a utility that may be restricted from taking an outage to relocate facilities during the shelter in place? Brad or Rick, do you want to address this?
Go ahead, Brad.
That's tricky given who our audience is. I think it's really going to depend on the specific circumstances and the provisions of whatever the relocation is taking place. I don't think there's a broad, bright line answer that I could provide to that. And I think it's really going to depend on the circumstances.
Yeah. We also have other questions. We know that registrants provided that we've tried to integrate as many as possible into the presentation, but there were some that were just a little bit outside of what we were planning to cover. And so we'll reach out to you personally about those questions that you may have posed to us. And with that, I think we are done. Yeah. Thanks for attending. We really appreciate everybody's participation, wonderful questions, and hopefully we can continue to update you guys as things continue to evolve with this situation.
And obviously anyone can feel free to reach out to any one of the five of us directly, send us an email, give us a call if there's other things you want to talk about in more detail. Obviously this is a tricky format to try to cover, and there's a lot of it, and please don't hesitate to reach out to us.
We also have a NOSTMAN COVID resource page available online, so if you have additional questions about COVID-19, you can go there too.
Yeah, and our California Eminent Domain blog also is going to be providing pretty regular updates, so that's another good resource to be following.
And the PowerPoint that we send out will have these links, we'll have additional resources. So, and we're going to add more after the webinar for issues that we've covered that aren't already in our resources page.
Thank you, everyone. Stay safe and healthy.